Marching forward. Next up, we have a special keynote address by the erudite American venture capitalist and a politician. It is my absolute honor to welcome Mr. Steve Wesley, founder and managing partner of the Wesley Group, one of the largest venture funds in North America focused on smart energy, transportation, and buildings. Steve is also a former Tesla board member, former senior vice president for marketing, business development, and international at eBay. Steve is also the former California state controller and has also served as a California state campaign co-chair for Senator John Kerry in 2004 and for Barack Obama in 2008. Welcome, Steve. I'd like to extend a warm, hearty namaste to you. We can't wait to hear your keynote. Thank you for joining us, and over to you.
Well, thank you. I'm delighted to be here. And congratulations to the thousands of you around the world who are Zooming in to be with us today. We're at a fascinating inflection point in history. We are facing perhaps the greatest challenge since any of us have been born, and that is the challenge of global warming. The big question lying out there is, can people figure out how to invest in the companies that will help prevent this disaster and ideally invest in those companies and make money at the same time? And this is what I founded our firm to do. So I'm going to show you a quick few slides today. I want to make this as proactive as possible. I'm going to give you a quick global tour of what's going on, talk about the trends that will shape your lives, and then give you a chance to ask questions. So with that, Tracy, why don't you fire up the first slide? We founded, next, our company 14 years ago. What's different about us, aside from the fact we have a 48% net IRR, we've already had 8 IPOs, including some of the biggest companies in the world, Luminar, Procore, Tesla, now with a market cap of over $780 billion, based on a simple premise. And that is the worlds of smart energy, smart transportation, smart buildings that used to be disparate. If you look back for the last 100 years, auto companies didn't care what the utilities did. Neither of them cared what building companies did. Today, these worlds of smart energy, mobility, and buildings are all converging. And that is what smart investors need to know to prepare for the future. We're lucky enough that with our fund, we've pulled together 16 of the world's largest energy and auto companies from around the world as LPs. We review over 2,600 companies a year, so we see a global network of everything that is happening to shape this new industries. And most importantly, some of you may not know this, but every venture firm in the world makes a commitment from their GP. Usually they just make 1%, occasionally 2%. At our firm, we have a 4% GP commitment to ensure we have complete skin in the game for everything we do. Tracy, next slide. What I want to do, let's take you back to 1965, because what I want you to all think about is, what does it take to build an enduring, great company? And if you look at this chart, you conclude two things. One, gee whiz, it felt pretty good to be an American back in 1965, because most all of the top or the biggest companies in the world were American. The second thing you'd note is virtually every company on this list is either an energy or an auto company. 6 oil companies, 3 auto companies dominating the top 10. Fast forward 45 years. And to be honest, not that much have changed. There's some new names there. A few foreign companies have popped onto the list, but it is still a list dominated by oil and energy companies. It's just, they're no longer all American flags. They're global flags. And the punchline is, for the last 60 years, we've lived in a world of oil and big car companies. And I'm here to tell you, that has all changed. So take a look from 2010, in just 10 years, look what's happened. Every oil company has dropped off the list. It's no longer just an American game, but it has moved to a competition between America and China amongst who's going to dominate the new big area, and that is the area of technology. And if you note, every energy and auto company here has fallen off except for one, and that's Tesla. And I'm about to make the case that the reason Tesla is doing so well is that they understand the world of mobility and energy are not two, they are one. Next slide. Oh, by the way, please note on that last slide, there is not one company on the right here that is in Europe, not one company in New York or even east of the Mississippi. We are squarely in a Pacific century. Next slide. We're going to say a little bit about trends. We're going to talk about this revolution in the cost of renewable energy, the electrification of everything, moving to a world of cybersecurity, and why that is so important as we move to a world of autonomous vehicles. And we're going to talk a little bit about why every company needs to develop a new 21st century menu. Next slide. This is one of my favorites. I actually worked back at the Department of Energy around 1980, and the cost per kilowatt to build solar was $77 a watt. And we all felt solar was wonderful. It was the answer. It was part of a cleaner future, but it's $77 a watt to build. No one was buying any. And that didn't change for decades as the price went down from 77 to 60 to 50 to 40 to 30 to 20. And I actually founded the firm, fast forward here to 2007. And if you can look at where the line was at 2007, cost of solar was about $4 a watt. And everybody in the world just looked backward and said, gee whiz, the green bars are the amount of solar produced in the world. We don't think solar is coming very quickly. And at our firm, we said, no, at $4 a watt, that is the inflection point. That is when everything will change. And we predicted these columns you see today in 2007. And do you know what everybody said? Crazy Californians, always thinking the world is going sustainable, not really in touch with reality. But here's what really happened in those next 8 years. And the year after that, and if you were to continue, you'd see it. This line goes even higher. We're living in a world of dramatically increased solar energy. And the message is, you can't predict the future by looking backward. You must predict the future. To predict the future accurately, you must look for the inflection point when the consumer will begin to change their behavior. We knew it was at $4 a watt back then. Let's take a look at this chart. On the left, it's the line in orange and in blue. And the simple point is this, looking backward from about 2015 and before, renewable energy was wonderful, but economically didn't make a lot of sense. But from basically 2017 on, what I want every one of you to know is that virtually every utility in the world is now going almost entirely sustainable or renewable energy. And the reason for that is, not only is it popular, not only is it better for the planet, but as this chart shows you, it is cheaper than any other energy source in virtually every part of the world. But historically, there's always been one thing holding back this revolution in sustainable energy. And that is, as you know, some days the sun doesn't shine, the wind doesn't blow. What do you do then? The answer is power storage. And I want you to take a look at the chart on the right, because this is everything you need to know about energy in one slide. I was serving on the board at Tesla, 2010, cost per kilowatt hour, $1,180. Simply put, we made at Tesla the world's finest electric car, faster than any Porsche when it was developed, even though it was a five-seater family car. It was the safest car ever made, and got the equivalent of 96 miles per gallon. One problem, at $1,180, the car cost over $90,000. It was essentially a plaything of the rich. It had started the electric car revolution, but it wasn't going to change the world just yet. But look what happened over the next decade. The cost of lithium-ion batteries went down 90%. And the striking thing about this chart is both Elon Musk and Herbert Diess have said they will take the cost of lithium ion batteries down another 50% by 2025. That's just 3.5 years from now. That is what's changed the world of energy and vehicles forever. So hold on just a minute, Tracy. I have a trivia question for all of you. If you needed to buy lithium ion batteries as we did in 2010, where would you go? How many factories in the world were there that actually sold lithium ion batteries? Every Tesla required over 6,000 lithium ion batteries. And we had to get on a plane and head out to Asia because at that point, some people think there were 100 or 50 or 20 lithium ion factories. In fact, take a look. Tracy, next slide. There were two, one by Panasonic in Japan, one by LG Chem. At Tesla, we had to stand in line. It's part of the reason Elon has exercised today about bringing battery production in-house so he'll never again be dependent on the whims of others. But take a look from just 2010 to 2020, Tracy, the number's gone from 2 to 192. This is what's driving costs down massively in ways that people have never seen before. This is why, and make no mistake about it, virtually every auto company on the planet is going all electric. We're no longer living in an age of oil. We're living in an age of lithium ion batteries. And the predictions are by the end of this decade that this number will have almost quintupled from 770 gigawatts to over 3.7 terawatts of energy. So the takeaway, we're living in an age of electrification of everything in an age of lithium ion batteries. Our firm, by the way, has looked at over 500 next gen battery companies trying to discern what comes next. We can talk more about that later. Next slide. So here's an interesting one, and it shows all of the forecasters about how quickly electric vehicles are going to come. Frankly, I think they're all conservative because they don't fully understand that you have a confluence of three factors: the decreasing cost of lithium ion batteries for sure, but the increasing demand for millennials with huge government mandates for incentives. And what people don't fully understand is if governments turn up those incentives as they have in Norway today, over 70% of all new cars sold in Norway are electric. You're gonna see more and more countries following suit, costs continuing to decline. Most people say you will see real electrification occur by 2040 or 2050. I'm here to tell you, next slide, Tracy, it's going to happen by 2030. In fact, I'm going to go further and say for most places in the world, you will not even be able to buy an internal combustion engine vehicle by 2030. The auto companies will just not be making them anymore. Next slide. You don't have to take my word for it. Just take a look at the stock market. Tesla today, higher market cap than Toyota, Volkswagen, Daimler, GM, BMW, Honda combined. And as of today, where Tesla's market cap, because they have once again beaten all analyst expectations, you can throw Hyundai into that mix and Ferrari as well. Tesla's market cap stretching close to $800 billion. Next slide. By the way, I'm proud to say I joined the board when there were 29 people at Tesla. When my wife heard that I came home one night and said, I've seen the future in 2007, it's electric vehicles. She said, please go get our money back. But that Tesla investment turned out okay. So how did Tesla create this crazy $780 billion market cap? They did it by doing the following. They were smart enough to realize they're not just a car company, they're an energy company, they're a vehicle company, and they're a building company, all in one. And they show up to the customer with a turnkey solution. And that is what other companies are going to have to do to catch up. Volkswagen, Toyota, they need to be energy companies as well as auto companies. Next slide. The big smackdowns to watch for is there's going to be a huge battle for who controls trucks. Ford has owned this, the number one selling vehicle in North America 40 years in a row, now has the E Ford 150. Tesla, with the crazy looking Cybertruck in the middle. I think it looks a little far-fetched, but they have 850,000 orders. Rivian in the right. That's the big trucking battle to watch for. Globally, it's probably Volkswagen versus Tesla. Volkswagen's moved faster than any traditional manufacturer to bring battery storage in-house. They're doing awfully well. The other smackdown to watch for is China versus the world. Today, close to half of all electric vehicles are produced in China. Whoever wins these battles will dominate the global mobility sector for the next 50 years. Next slide. I want to switch over and talk to you about the world of IoT and cybersecurity. And some of you are going to say, hey, I thought this was a talk about sustainability. And it is. But the way to get to net carbon zero, neutral, and the way to usher in this revolution in sustainable energy is to understand that you're going to have IoT devices in every part of our life. You can't have smart, energy-efficient homes without IoT devices, and you certainly can't have autonomous vehicles without IoT devices. And when you have IoT devices on everything, and we're heading to a world where we're estimates made by experts of over 42 billion connected devices, including things like the Fitbit I'm wearing today, you have to have cybersecurity on every one of those, especially as the global transportation network goes increasingly autonomous. The amount of ransomware damage claims is going through the ceiling, and every company who's listening today needs to be thinking about what you're doing, not only to protect your enterprise, but every IoT device out there. Take a look at this next chart we put together. A lot of companies you've heard of, McAfee, Symantec, Palo Alto Networks, made tens of billions of dollars by serving just 4 million customers that sit in the top of that pyramid. They provided enterprise software. And frankly, it wasn't that hard, because when you have unlimited big iron from IBM or whichever mainframe maker you use, you can figure out how to protect it using software. The big battle that's being waged today is which software companies are going to win the fight to provide endpoint cybersecurity. And that's a much tougher challenge, because you have to produce software that serves on the CPU of your smart devices like this one. And the punchline, or the payoff, is you're no longer looking to serve 4 million companies, you're looking to serve $4 billion users. The two winners to date are CrowdStrike and one of our companies called SentinelOne, together market cap of over $70 billion. But the battle of the future is going to be which cybersecurity company will figure out how to get protection on every IoT device in the world, because I'm here to tell you now, every car of the future will have 5 to 10 IoT devices and at least that many in the home. So keep an eye on cybersecurity. Next slide. I just want to say a quick word. Most companies have had a very small menu of things to sell. If you're a utility, you would show up selling electrons, maybe gas molecules, and that was it. If you're a car company, you sell boxes with wheels. Some of them are faster, some look cooler, but it was really about every year how many boxes you sold. In the future, every industry, whether it's energy or vehicles, are going to have to come up in buildings with a brand new 21st century industry. What we do is we help companies walk through what these new 21st century menus look like. Next slide. Let's take a look. In the energy sector, if you're a utility, for example, you're not ever you're going to be able to provide not only more than electricity, you're going to have to provide solar, storage, assets, home devices, customer engagement, clean energy offerings, and so on. You're also going to have a whole new resume menu for your commercial customers. Next slide. And that might look something like this. Go ahead, Tracy. And even though you're a utility, you're also going to need to have a mobility menu. And it would look something like this. And you might even have to, Tracy, next slide, have a fourth menu that looks a bit like this. Next menu. With resilience and asset management. The point is, for every one of you sitting out there, whether you're in energy, mobility, buildings, or some other sector, the challenge for you is understanding that you can't predict the future by looking backwards. You have to predict the future by looking for the inflection points that will change your industry, just like the precipitous downward cost curve of renewable energy combined with the low cost of power storage has transformed our energy world. And the question is, do you know what your 21st century menu should look like? Next slide. I love telling this story. This is when I founded our firm 14 years ago. People said, Steve, we love sustainable energy, but who's making any money? Show us the picture of all the unicorns, the billion-dollar companies in your sector. And the answer is, there were none 14 years ago. But today, this field of sustainable energy and mobility that I've been speaking about has gone from being really nowhere to, in fact, the fastest growing sector in the global economy, just as you saw on those first charts. Firms like Tesla and Uber are changing the global landscape. I'm proud our small firm managed to get into six of them, and I'm proud of the team for doing so. But I want every one of you to know this is the new future for energy and mobility. And with that, let me close on the last slide. When I was growing up, my father always told me one thing, and it was sage advice in the 1960s. And that is, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And that worked pretty well because in the 1960s, things didn't move very quickly. Today, you can throw that advice out the window. The new mantra for the new century is, if you're not busy cannibalizing yourself, someone else will. And it comes from Steve Jobs. And as someone who runs a venture firm on Sandhill Road in Silicon Valley, I can tell you, every firm in the world is being cannibalized now. And if you're not looking for the next big thing, you will be like one of those companies I showed you on the very first slide that drops off the list a decade or two later. It's a challenge to all of you as entrepreneurs. You live in an age of innovation, and I want to challenge you to be the Steve Jobs of the next generation. With that, let me pause here. I know I covered a lot of material quickly. We'd love to answer any questions people might have from anywhere in the world. And I think we have the ability to put some of those in chat, but go ahead. Let's see what people have.
Hi, Mr. Steve. This is Ashith here from the TSS 2021 Organizing Committee.
Great. Good to see you. Any questions in the audience today?
Yes, sir. We have a couple. First of all, I'd like to say it is an honor to speak to you. And today's presentation has been so warm and thought-provoking. It was an amazing experience just to watch it.
Well, thank you. It's wonderful to be here. I love to challenge the crowd. I want to hear the questions. Let's make all this right, interactive. Sir.
So first off, so we know today that climate change is a systemic problem of the modern world, whether it's transportation, electricity, industry. So as someone with significant experience in both business as well as governance and administration, the question is, when you make a decision, how do you balance between both of these parts of your life, both of these sides of your mind to ensure a sufficiently positive outcome for the environment?
So let me touch on three points. First, global warming is the existential threat of the day. And it's not just about the planet getting a little warmer and maybe we're going to have some storms. Already today, there's massive amounts of pollution. The Harvard Health Project has said China alone will see 83 million people dying from lung-related diseases. This is from pollution. We see about 7 million people a year die of increasing impacts of heat and climate. So this isn't something that is merely affecting the polar bears or the climate. It's not a 100-year problem, it's a now problem. The next point that comes along is, we should go greener, but it's so expensive, I'm not sure we can afford it. That is why I wanted to give every person on this presentation the facts I wanted you to see the cost down curves for the last 50 years. What I want you to know is sustainable energy costs less than carbon-based fuels every part of the planet today. Now let me put my venture capital hat on. We look at over 2,600 companies a year, and what we're looking at is for firms that understand these global trends, but have a real business model. And I want to speak specifically to the entrepreneurs. We're looking for companies that have figured out how to get a 60 or 70% gross margin. We no longer live in a world of manufacturing or where manufacturing is the future. It's important. It's not going to go away overnight. But what we're really focused on is the digitization of energy, the opportunity to use IoT devices to bring this new world forward more quickly. And it's happening faster than you think. But we're looking for firms, fast growth curve, large gross margins. And when you combine those two together, and it happens all the time, that's why you're going to see more and more companies on that slide I just showed you that have a higher market cap like Tesla than all of their competitors behind. Be part of making that new future.
Amazing. Thank you. So that was question number one. Question number two is, you know, just as, you know, now cars getting batteries is almost commonplace. What are your thoughts on, you know, battery powered flights?
So 10 years ago, if you'd said, hey, Steve, you're a big fan of electric vehicles. Do you think we're going to see electric aircraft? And I would have said, hey, there's one thing I know for sure. You're not going to see a lot of electric aircraft because batteries are heavy and planes need to be in the air. I'm here to tell you right now, I was wrong. We're seeing a revolution in the number of electric aircraft companies more than we ever dreamed. The power density is improving. Cost is going down, weight is coming out. Here's the punchline. You're not going to see commercial aircraft taking people across either the Pacific or the Atlantic anytime in the near future. But what you will see is an increasing number of aircraft that are serving the sub 1 hour market, even in commercial flights. Norway, interestingly enough, has said by 2040, they will no longer allow sub 1 hour flights that are non-electric. So just know we're entering into an age of electric aircraft. They will start with short haul, usually commuter flights. Think about, say, Manhattan to Kennedy Airport or Palo Alto to San Francisco or Orange County to LA, London to Paris. This new world of electric aircraft is coming. Watch out for the firm eVTOLs. You're going to see a lot more in that area, just as you did a revolution in the auto sector.
Incredible. That's incredible. All right. Next up is, so a common argument made against electric vehicles and specifically electric cars these days is that, you know, the electricity that powers them is like most likely coming from burning fossil fuels anyway. Is that true? And if so, how do we shift into more renewable sources?
So that's not true. In places like California, you're already seeing close to 40% of all electricity being generated by renewable sources. And as I said in the very beginning, globally, not just in liberal California or those lovely Western European countries and Scandinavia, globally today, close to 70% of all new power that goes online is renewable. And that number is going up. So here's something to think about. And this is just for America. But I want to paint this picture. It's important to understand. Jimmy Carter came out in 1977 and said, we must have CAFE standards. The auto companies must make more fuel efficient vehicles. And he said, 25 miles per gallon. We must have that as an average fleet. And the Chamber of Commerce and the auto companies all said, this is terrible. He's a socialist. It's a job killer. We can't do it. And of course he could, because people in Europe have higher gas prices. They're already had more fuel efficient vehicles anyway. No changes whatsoever for 40 years. And then President Obama comes along and says, it's time to change CAFE standards in the United States. We're going to raise it from 25 miles a gallon to 36 miles a gallon. And what did people say? He's a socialist. It's terrible. It's a job killer, even though Volkswagen and everybody else is already making cars that get higher fuel standards. Here's the reality. Tesla comes out just 5 years after that pronouncement. Forget 35 miles a gallon. The Tesla gets 96 miles a gallon. fuel equivalent. But here's the answer to your question. It's not 96 miles per gallon in every state. In places like Wyoming, where there's a lot of coal, the carbon equivalent of that Tesla is about 50 miles per gallon, still 2x any other vehicle. But in California, where 40% is renewable, heading to 50%, the fuel efficiency of a Tesla is over 250 miles per gallon. This is the future for the planet. The faster we can go electric, the better. The challenge is for the next generation of countries, not just Western Europe and the Western US, but China and India, to bring in more solar and more wind. 5 years ago, too expensive. Today, it's the new future. I urge all of you, urge your countries to go all sustainable. It makes the path to electric vehicles faster, with planes, trucks, and boats not far behind. Let's take another question or two if you have time.
That's it. We have just one more question, sir, and we're going to close right after that, and we're tight on time as well, so I'll make this quick. You know, a big part of your presentation was focused on, you know, an interconnected mesh and web of devices, especially IoT and cybersecurity becoming such a big deal now. So what is your take on AI security and the likelihood of rogue AI devices in the future?
With the likelihood of a what?
The likelihood of rogue AI devices in the future.
So make no mistake, the biggest issues we live with in the world, as we solve many of these other issues, bring costs down, smart devices, it's going to change the world in many ways for the better. The two issues everyone should be thinking about are, who is protecting my privacy? Has the government set reasonable standards? And are we ensuring and requiring that companies not steal our data without knowing about this? And then on the rogue side, make no mistake, there will always be haves and have-nots, and the have-nots will always be targeting the haves. As we move to this new world, especially of autonomous vehicles, homes that are controlled by smart devices, everybody needs to be thinking about this new world of IoT cybersecurity. That is why I showed the pyramid chart. So keep an eye. Companies like CrowdStrike and SentinelOne, I believe, are likely to see on that 10 biggest companies list in the future. But every one of us is going to need to focus on it. And I dare say, all of the money that the United States spends in the Pentagon for tanks and bombers and big ships is slowly going to follow the model of what the Israelis have smartly done with their 8200 division, where they put their money and their best and brightest into cyber protection, not tanks and planes. Military must move into the future just like everyone else. With that, thank you all for giving me a chance to speak to you. We're entering into a whole new world, a Pacific century. You're all going to be part of it, and I appreciate you letting me spend a few minutes with you today. Thank you.